Hi everyone, I hope you are all having a great week. This week is a very special week in the church as we're celebrating Holy Week. Now Holy Week is a time where we pray and journey with Christ through his passion. His passion is his suffering and death on the cross and his resurrection from the dead. Holy Week is the time where we focus on our salvation and the importance that this most perfect of sacrifices has on our lives. Holy Week is comprised of five different liturgical celebrations: Palm Sunday, Holy Thursday, Good Friday, Holy Saturday, and Easter Sunday. And in this video, I want to provide you all with a quick look at all these celebrations and what they mean for us as followers of Christ. Now, as a reminder, you can view all of our Holy Week celebrations live on our website at www.falmouthcatholic.org. We'll be celebrating Holy Week at the following times: Holy Thursday at 7 o'clock p.m. in the evening, Good Friday at 3 o'clock p.m. in the afternoon, the Easter Vigil on Holy Saturday at 7 o'clock p.m. in the evening, and Easter Sunday at 7:30 a.m., 8:45 a.m., and 11 o'clock a.m. So to begin Holy Week, we start off with the celebration of Palm Sunday. On Palm Sunday, we remember Christ's triumphal entrance into Jerusalem. In the Gospels, we read about how Jesus and his disciples were making their way into the city for the celebration of Passover, and there was a crowd of people waiting for them to arrive. Now take a minute to picture this scene. Picture a city like Boston or New York, and picture hundreds and hundreds of people standing on a sidewalk, cheering and clapping, full of joy. Maybe think about a parade like the Patriots Super Bowl parade or the Macy's Thanksgiving Day parade. Think about the happiness that people are experiencing. Think how excited they must be. That joy and that excitement that you might feel at a parade is exactly what was being experienced by the people present during this triumphal entrance into Jerusalem. They got to witness Jesus. They were experiencing Jesus and his disciples, and it was a very joyful time for them. One of the most prominent images we see during the Palm Sunday Mass is the blessing and use of palm branches. We use palm branches to help remind us about this triumphal entrance of Christ into Jerusalem. During the Gospel, at the beginning of the Palm Sunday Mass, we hear how the people cut the branches from the trees and placed them on the road for Jesus to walk upon. Now that must have been an amazing sight to have seen all these palm branches strewn across the road for Jesus to walk upon. Truly was an exciting time. But our celebration of Palm Sunday is not just a celebration full of joy. From that triumphant entrance, we are quickly reminded about why Jesus was entering into Jerusalem, so that he might sacrifice himself on the cross for all of humankind. While the crowds of people, and even Jesus' own disciples, were experiencing a happy moment, Christ knew that a very serious trial awaited him. During the Palm Sunday Mass, we are reminded of the somber side of Holy Week when we hear the reading of the Passion narrative. It is in this reading that we hear about the suffering and the eventual death that Christ endured. It is a stark reminder as we enter into the events of the Passion more closely through the rest of our celebrations of Holy Week. After Palm Sunday, our week continues in prayer and reflection until we begin the Triduum, or the Great 3 Days. These are the days of Holy Thursday, Good Friday, and Holy Saturday. And this is a time where we enter intimately into the Passion of Christ. Our celebration of the Triduum takes place over these 3 days and should be seen as one long celebration rather than 3 separate ones. We begin the Triduum on Holy Thursday with the Mass of the Lord's Supper. It is during the celebration where we remember the final meal that Christ shared with his disciples, which we call the Last Supper. It is during the celebration that we also commemorate the institution of the Eucharist and the sacramental priesthood. Our celebration of the Mass begins as we usually do, with a procession and the introductory rites. We then continue into the liturgy of the word as normal and end with a homily. After the homily, we add a special part to the Mass. At this point, we witness a reenactment of one of the scenes from the Last Supper, the washing of the feet. On the night of the Last Supper, Jesus took it upon himself to wash the feet of his disciples. And during our celebration on Holy Thursday, the priest does this once again for the members of the community. The washing of the feet is more than just a simple recreation, but is a reminder of the life of service that Christ has instructed us to live. In the Gospel of John, we hear this about the washing of the feet. "So when he had washed their feet and put his garments back on and reclined at table again, he said to them, Do you realize what I have done for you? You call me teacher and master, and rightly so, for indeed I am. If I, therefore, the master and teacher, have washed your feet, you ought to wash one another's feet. I have given you a model to follow, so that as I have done for you, you should also do. Jesus is telling us that we need to serve others and live a life that is dedicated to meet the needs of the people around us. It should not be about us, but the ones that we love. Due to the ongoing COVID-19 situation, we have been instructed to not carry out the washing of the feet during our celebration of the Holy Thursday liturgy. But I encourage each of you as a family to do this practice in the comfort of your own homes. All you need is a pitcher of water, a basin, and a towel. And this is a great activity to do together as a family to enter more closely into this Holy Thursday liturgy. After the washing of the feet, we enter into the liturgy of the Eucharist. On Holy Thursday, this moment of the Mass has extra importance as we once again recall the words that Christ said at the Last Supper. I want to now read a quick story from the Gospel of Matthew about the Last Supper. While they were eating, Jesus took bread, said the blessing, broke it, and giving it to his disciples said, "Take and eat, this is my body." Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them saying, "Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which will be shed on behalf of many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, from now on I shall not drink this fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it with you new in the kingdom of my Father." If you listen to this story closely, you would hear some very familiar words. Jesus says, "Take and eat, this is my body, and drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood." These are the same words that are said by the priests during the Mass. When we celebrate Mass, these words are used to help bring us into that moment of Jesus' sacrifice, and on Holy Thursday, this idea of Christ's sacrifice has more meaning to it, as we are in the midst of our remembrance of that particular moment. We as Catholics believe that when these same words are said by a priest during Mass, that the ordinary bread and wine that have been offered up as a sacrifice from the community becomes the body and blood of Christ that is offered up as a sacrifice for all of humanity. We call this the real presence or true presence of Christ. To hear more about our understanding of the Eucharist, be sure to check out the other video that I put out called A First Eucharist Retreat. After communion, we then conclude our Holy Thursday celebration with a solemn procession. During this procession, we take the Eucharist that had just been consecrated and place it in repose for us to pray in silent adoration. The reason why we do this is to help remind us of what the disciples did after the Last Supper. Again, from the Gospel of Matthew, we read, "Then Jesus came with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, 'Sit here while I go over there and pray.' He took along Peter and the two sons of Zebedee and began to feel sorrow and distress. Then he said to them, 'My soul is sorrowful even to death. Remain here and keep watch with me.' He advanced a little and fell prostrate in prayer, saying, 'My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me, yet not as I will, but as you will.' When he returned to his disciples, he found them asleep. He said to Peter, 'So you could not keep watch with me for 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not undergo the test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak.' Withdrawing a second time, he prayed again, 'My Father, if it is not possible that this cup pass without my drinking it, your will be done.' Then he returned once more and found them asleep, for they could not keep their eyes open. He left them and withdrew again and prayed a third time, saying the same thing again. Then he returned to his disciples and said to them, 'Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Behold, the hour is at hand when the Son of Man is to be handed over to sinners. Get up, let us go. Look, my betrayer is at hand.'" In this passage, Jesus instructed his disciples to watch and pray over him as he went to pray alone. In our remembrance of these events of Holy Week, so too are we called to watch and pray for Jesus. This is a time for us to be intimately with Christ in prayer and to really be with him in those final moments before we remember his death on the cross the following day. It is a time where we can unite with him in peace and quiet. Following our celebration of the Mass of the Lord's Supper on Holy Thursday, we then enter into Good Friday. Good Friday is the most solemn of days in our faith when we remember Christ's greatest sacrifice for humanity, his suffering and death on the cross. The cross is such a powerful image for us as followers of Christ. It is the image that is imprinted on our souls. The cross symbolizes our salvation, that through Christ's suffering and death on the cross, we are brought into new life. Death no longer has the final say. We now have hope that there is life after death. The cross, once an instrument of suffering and darkness, has become the way for us to experience joy and light. We are given hope that we will be able to share in the love of God for all of eternity. When we look to the cross, we realize just how important Jesus' death on it was for us. I'm sure many of you have felt pain in your lives, or at the very least know someone who has felt great pain. And I'm not just talking about physical pain, but emotional, mental, spiritual pain as well. Some of you may be even experiencing pain even now. Jesus' suffering and dying on the cross shows us just how much God loves us. And his love for us goes so far that God is willing to experience our greatest harm and fear just so that we can come to experience further his love. God, through his son Jesus, knows what suffering is. God can give us the strength, give us the hope to move through our suffering. And I think that we can look to the cross for solidarity, that even God is willing to suffer with us because God loves us and God feels for us. As Catholics, we believe in a suffering Messiah, a savior who, in order to be our savior, has to suffer. If Jesus didn't suffer, if he didn't die, if he didn't rise from the dead, we would probably just think of him as a brilliant talker, a brilliant thinker, a great mind in the world. But the fact that he was willing to suffer for us, to lay down his life, I think that is a true act of love right there. It makes him more than just a brilliant talker, but our savior. Regardless of whatever suffering you or someone else might be going through, you are not alone. Even when everyone may seem to abandon you, the love of God will never abandon you. And it's something that you will have to learn to trust, even if you can't notice right away. Jesus is with us always in our suffering because he too was alone in those final moments of his suffering, and he knows what it's like. So our celebration of Good Friday reflects the solemn nature of Christ's death and honors the image of the cross. Our Good Friday liturgy takes place at 3:00 p.m. in the afternoon, as that is the time that is given to us in the Bible about when Jesus died on the cross. We read in the Gospels, and about 3:00, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Some of the bystanders who heard it said, "This one is calling for Elijah." Immediately, one of them ran in to get a sponge. He soaked it in wine and, putting it on a reed, gave it to him to drink. But the rest just said, "Wait, let us see if Elijah comes to save him." But Jesus cried out again in a loud voice and gave up his spirit. So we begin our Good Friday celebration at 3:00 in the afternoon. And our celebration of the Good Friday is a little bit different than how we normally do our typical Mass throughout the year. One of the first things that you might notice at the beginning of the Good Friday service is that the priest, deacon, and altar servers lying down in front of the altar. This is an act we call prostration, and it's a deep form of prayer. When we prostrate ourselves, we are totally submitting to God, and it is a sign of our humility, our laying down of our lives for the one who gave up his life for us. Our service continues as normal with readings from Scripture. For the Gospel, we once again read the Passion narrative like we did on Palm Sunday, where we walk with Christ on his final steps leading to his ultimate death on the cross. On Good Friday, the words of the Passion have deeper meaning for us as we are truly present with Christ in that moment. After the homily comes a truly special moment in the liturgy when we are given a chance to venerate the cross ourselves. To venerate something means to treat something with respect and reverence, and that is exactly what we do when we venerate the cross on Good Friday. During the liturgy, we are given the opportunity to kneel before, touch, or even kiss the cross as a sign of the love and respect we have for the sacrifice that Christ has made for us. As a family, consider taking time on Good Friday to venerate a personal crucifix in your own home. It is a great way to show your devotion, even if you can't physically be present in the church. After the veneration of the cross, where we typically would have the Liturgy of the Eucharist during a regular Mass, we move into simply giving out Holy Communion to the community. Good Friday is the only celebration of the year where we do not consecrate any new Eucharist, as we are reminded of Christ's death in that moment. We actually use what was consecrated on Holy Thursday for our Holy Communion celebration on Good Friday. This is also reflected in removing of the Eucharist from the tabernacle, leaving it empty. From our solemn celebration on Good Friday, we enter into a brief period of waiting, just like the disciples were in waiting after Jesus died on the cross. It is a time where we sit in contemplation and reflection, thinking about the sacrifice that Jesus has just made for us. We continue this period of waiting until the evening, when we enter into the longest Mass of the year, which we call the Easter Vigil. Now, if you haven't experienced the Easter Vigil before, I encourage you to consider watching it this year, as it is one of the most beautiful and awe-inspiring liturgies we have put together. It is truly a sight to behold. The Easter Vigil typically begins outside in front of a fire. We use the image of fire to help remind us that Christ is the light that will bring us out of darkness. In front of the fire, it is when we bless the Easter candle, the large candle that will be lit throughout all the Easter season, and is the candle from which we light our candles from during our baptism. We then process into the church, where the deacon will hold the Easter candle upright and proclaim, "Christ our light," which is a reminder that Christ lights our path. During this moment too, the community will have candles lit from the flame of the Easter candle, and the whole church will be illuminated with candlelight. It's almost like stars lighting up the night sky. Since we cannot be physically present this year at the vigil, I encourage each of you to light a candle in your home or place a light in your window as a sign of unity with the light of Christ. After the procession in, the priest will then begin a very long but beautiful prayer known as the Exultet. The Exultet is a prayer that tells us to rejoice because Christ has conquered death and brought us into new and eternal life. It is the prayer of our Easter faith. I want to give you a brief excerpt from the Exultet just so you can hear the beauty of the words that we use to rejoice and pray. This is the night when Christ broke the prison bars of death and rose victorious from the underworld. A wonder of your humble care for us. O love, O charity, beyond all telling, to ransom a slave you gave away your son. O truly necessary sin of Adam, destroyed completely by the death of Christ. After the Exultet, we move into the Liturgy of the Word. Rather than just the typical two readings and a responsorial psalm in between, we can hear up to seven readings from Scripture with a responsorial psalm in between. It's kind of a lot of readings, but the reason why there are so many readings is that these are readings that detail the story of our salvation. They are readings that go from our creation, found in the book of Genesis, to the story of the Passover in the book of Exodus, to the prophecy of the Savior found in the writings of the Old Testament prophets of Isaiah, Baruch, and Ezekiel. Following the Gospel reading and the homily, we move into another special part of the liturgy where we celebrate the sacraments of initiation. We receive into the church those adults who have been preparing to receive the sacraments of baptism, confirmation, and the Eucharist. These adults have gone through a program known as the Rite of Christian Initiation of Adults, also known as the RCIA, and have been studying about our Catholic faith over the course of the year, just like how many of our youth have been doing so in their faith formation classes. It is also during this time where we as a community renew our own baptismal promises and are reminded of being followers of Christ. We then move into the Liturgy of the Eucharist, where once again ordinary bread and wine become the body and blood of Christ. At the Easter Vigil, we become more illuminated in our understanding of the Eucharist as we are in the presence of Christ, whose death and resurrection made this gift possible for us to partake in. From the night of the Vigil, we then move into the dawn of the Easter Sunday, where we revel in the resurrection of Christ. On Easter Sunday, we celebrate the joy and the hope that Christ's resurrection from the dead has given us. We are bathed in the light that comes from the conquering of sin and death. We hear the words, Alleluia, and we are reminded of the joys that that brings. The great thing about Easter is that it's not just reserved for one day, but a whole season where we give thanks to God for this most amazing gift. The season of Easter goes from Easter Sunday to Pentecost and is reflected of the time that Jesus spent with his disciples after rising from the dead and before his ascension into heaven. The Easter season is a time of rejoicing, a time of happiness, Life has found new meaning in the resurrection, and we are forever changed because of it. We are called to go out into the world and proclaim the message of the risen Christ, to share the same joy with other people. As we head towards our celebration of Easter this year, I want to express my gratitude for all of you in your prayers and your support. May the risen Christ be within your hearts as we celebrate this most amazing times in the life of our church. Happy Easter.